Welcome to Sun City, everyone. You ain't seen nothing yet. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to CoolCaveTravel.com for fun and informative travel videos. You just ain't seen nothing yet. Sun City. If you've just joined us, this is part two of the story of the meteoric rise of the iconic Sun City Resort that was the brainchild of the South African hotel magnate Sol Kersner. The resort was born out of a sinister exploitation of apartheid-era laws that created phony homelands where black migrant labor was dumped over weekends in South Africa. We are now approaching 1985, and against all odds, Sun City is defying gravity. During its opening weekend in 1979, it attracted more than 10,000 visitors, and by now, nearly 6 years later, more than 10 million visitors have elbowed their way through its glitzy casinos, chasing fantasies and escapism from their daily grind under the apartheid regime. Its glam-fabulous Super Bowl was attracting the biggest superstars on the planet, thanks to the staggering payouts made possible by the proceeds from dirty tax-free gambling money. But the cracks were starting to show. Artists playing Sun City were getting into progressively more trouble back home for playing here and were being blacklisted by the United Nations. When Queen played here in 1984, they tried to appease the international community by making a donation to a local school for the deaf and blind, but that didn't fly. They were called out and vilified in the British and American press. Then, in 1985, came two gigantic body blows. The first blow came from Durban and happened on 15 August 1985, when the then president of the apartheid regime, P.W. Botha, gave his infamous Rubicon speech. It was widely expected that he would announce the reforms so desperately fought for by the ANC, including the release of Nelson Mandela. The speech was actually written for him and ready to be delivered. Except somewhere along the way, he veered off script and told the international community to get lost. This was the last straw, and the next day, this is exactly what most international business did. They packed up and left. The second blow came from overseas. Fed up with artists selling out to Sun City, Artists United Against Apartheid was a protest group founded by activist and performer Steven Van Zandt, who is best known as being a member of Bruce Springsteen's E Street Band, and record producer Arthur Baker, in order to protest against apartheid in South Africa. The group produced the song and album Sun City, which was released on 25 October 1985. The song reached number 38 on the US Billboard Hot 100 chart in December 85 and caught the mood of the times. Sun City now had a catchy song calling it out for being the twisted pillar strutting up a twisted regime that it essentially is. There's only one thing we can do. We got to say in the blink of an eye, the glitter on the once unstoppable and unbeatable Kersner cash cow fluttered away overnight. Bookings dried up immediately. There was no more denying it. Sun City was a pariah resort in a pariah nation. And by the late 80s, the once bedazzling Super Bowl was reduced to hosting Tupperware parties and dog shows. But that was only the start of the troubles. As we hurtled towards the 1990s, South Africa became frighteningly unstable. The ANC's call to the masses to make the country ungovernable was being heeded, and a state of emergency was declared by Botha. South Africa experienced a disturbing escalation of political violence unprecedented in scope, intensity, and nature. Facilitated by a world-class road network, the HIV/AIDS epidemic was also spreading like wildfire. When the Berlin Wall came down in November 1989, the last ounce of support from America and Britain for the apartheid regime vanished, as there was no more reason to back this embarrassment of a pariah state to carry on fighting communism in Southern Africa. Less than 3 months later, in February 1990, Mandela was released. As the world rejoiced over this incredible development, the future future of South Africa looked more uncertain than ever before. The far right was threatening civil war. It was unclear what the mightiest army in Africa was going to do. The leaders of the Mickey Mouse homelands like Bobuta Tswana were stoking anger as they did not want to give up power, and the black masses had enough of being repressed. Racial tension was being stoked everywhere, and the nation was staring down the abyss. It were really scary times indeed. Sun City was now facing multiple existential threats. International tourism was dead in the water. The economy was tanking under severe international sanctions. It was impossible to attract big names. Whatever the outcome in such an uncertain future, the one thing that was certain by now is that South Africa was changing beyond recognition, and the pace of that change was accelerating. Soon gambling would be legalized all over the country, and the homelands would be reintegrated into South Africa, which would be the knockout blow for Sun City. Any reasonable person would have cashed in their chips and walk away by now. But not Saul Kersner, everyone. Pictured here with his wife, Annelien Kriel, who he married in 1980, which was the ultimate coronation of white privilege when the Sun King married Miss World of 1974. In 1990, 4 years before the first democratic election, while South Africa was in the grip of fear and uncertainty and violence, Kersner started on his biggest project yet. In a true build it and they will come, putting all your chips on the table, go big or go home fashion, Kersner decided to go all in at Sun City one more time and build another 5-star resort hotel that will be the last word in luxury and opulence. Except this time, no casino will be added. Kersner was acutely aware that Sun City needed to pivot away from its deliciously sinful roots and become a family-friendly destination. It was here where Kersner and his team's imagination ran riot, with a story told of the hotel being inspired by an ancient myth of a beautiful African kingdom in an ancient volcano lost to the jungle after an earthquake. At the time, it was the largest construction project in Africa and the largest landscaping project in the world. It shall be a $550 million in today's money African theme park, with the glitziest hotel ever to be built on African soil. Everything shall be hand-carved, hand-woven, hand-sculpted, and everything shall be custom-made for the hotel. It shall have a 25-hectare man-made jungle, replete with streams, waterfalls, hiking trails, and ruined temples. And it shall have an enormous water park with a giant computerized wave pool and some of the scariest water slides on Earth. And it shall have another superlative golf course with a crocodile pit at the 13th hole. And there shall be fake rock everywhere. Welcome to the palace, everyone. In December 1992, the Palace of the Lost City opened in a blaze of publicity so big it would have made Donald Trump blush. A bizarre Vegas Disney-style hybrid that was by far the most impressive resort in Africa, built to put the South African tourism industry back on the international stage. Once again, Kersner had pulled it off and everyone flocked back to Sun City. When a new South Africa emerged from apartheid in 1994 after peaceful and free elections, Kersner's crown jewel was ready to welcome the world. It was a roaring success, and this time around, it had the endorsement from the likes of Nelson Mandela, Naomi Campbell, and Michael Jackson, who loved it so much he nearly bought a stake in the place in 1996. This timepiece from 1992 is still here exactly the way it was built back then. The hotel has the eccentric kitsch of Port Marion in Wales or the Royal Pavilion in Brighton, but on an infinitely grander scale. Whatever you think of it, low rent Vegas or not, it's hard not to be awestruck, and it saved the resort in its darkest hour. The glam fabulous, completely dark space age casino that was built here in the entertainment center in 1981 as an entrance to the Super Bowl has now given way to a light and airy family-friendly space full of family-friendly restaurants and children's games and activities. They even opened up the roof to let in some natural light.
Today, the resort is as super popular as it has ever been.
Sun City represents incredibly good value, especially for overseas tourists. Only a two-hour drive away from Africa's largest and busiest airport, you can see the Big Five in one day in the Pilanesberg Nature Reserve, which is right on its doorstep. You can have up-close experiences with wild rescued animals in several different sanctuaries. You can have endless family fun in beautifully manicured gardens. The food and service is definitely not low-rent Vegas. In fact, I would compare the service levels here with any of the major hotels on the Las Vegas Strip. But to me, the resort represents so much more. It is an icon that occupies a significant place in South African history. Even though it was the dirty love child of the overflowing greed and corruption of the apartheid regime, ironically and unintentionally, its Super Bowl helped put the political situation in South Africa under a magnifying glass, drawing unprecedented negative attention and outrage. For privileged whites, generally gregarious people who yearn to be liked by the world, the boycott of Sun City took an immeasurable psychological toll. For South African pop fans, the arrival of big international acts was like manna from heaven. When Saul Kersner started bringing in those top guys, it was huge. People were so hungry for contact with the outside world. While the cultural boycott lacked the teeth of more publicized economic sanctions, its effects were more deeply felt in the day-to-day lives of most white people who avidly follow American popular culture and despaired at being shunned by their favorite singers and actors. This was a major contributing factor in the yes outcome of the 1992 referendum, when the white population was basically asked if universal suffrage should be granted in South Africa. During a time when South Africa faced its grimmest hours, the palace not only represented Saul Kersner's unshaken belief in the future of South Africa, it also represented a new hope. Since Bobuta Tswana was never internationally recognized as a country, Sun City was the first place in South Africa where black people could enter without being a servant. It was the first place in South Africa where black and white people were allowed to mix in whatever way they wanted. It was the first business in South Africa that invested in training and development of black employees in managerial and executive positions, which means it was the first South African employer where black people could have some sort of career beyond cleaning, gardening, farming, or pumping gas. As a testimony of how far the resort has come, the general manager of the Palace Hotel, Josiah Moncho, started working as a night porter at the Cascade Hotel when he was 19 in 1986. Sun City was way ahead of its time when it came to recycling, especially water, since it had to pump its water from miles away. In keeping with the tradition of being the centerfold of controversy in South Africa, in June 2013, a lavish wedding was thrown by the thuggish Gupta family from India that was stealing the country blind, aided by the stewardship of ex-president Jacob Zuma. The entire resort was booked out and paid for by aid money that was supposed to go to black dairy farmers. It was this event, alongside the landing of their personal jets at the military Waterkloof Air Base without authorization, that exposed the scale of the corruption that prompted the Guptas being thrown out of the country and all of their assets seized. Once again, Sun City had shone a light on everything that was wrong in South Africa. Did Saul Kersner exploit apartheid-era laws to become fabulously wealthy? Yes, absolutely. But he also left South Africa in a much better state than he found it. Thanks to the insane risks that Kersner took, combined with the innovation and standards that he introduced to the South African tourism industry, South Africa today is one of the top tourist destinations in the world. Pre-pandemic times, the industry was the fastest growing sector of the economy. A special thanks to the amazing staff at Sun City, who made sure that I had a fabulously memorable stay. I can't wait to come back, and to anybody who would consider coming here, I would say, I would never say no to a weekend in Sun City. Thank you for joining us, everybody, and have a lovely day.